10:18, I believe that's today. Ken and Margaret Fogg of Oakwood Road do not oppose Ken Maxwell's proposal before the planning board, and they wanted that noted for the planning board. We also had another call from Mrs. Burbank on Spurwink Avenue, who is also not opposed to Mr. Maxwell's proposal. A letter to the town tax assessor, Mr. Daigle, from Nathaniel Clifford, dated October 17th, regarding the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and its preparation to accept a conservation easement on Spinnaker Heights. And a letter from T.Y. Lynn, Mr. Hunter, dated October 12th, on the Maxwell Farm Stand site. A letter to Robert Taylor from Mr. McGovern, the town manager, excerpting minutes of the October 12th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council concerning the final acceptance, the conditional final acceptance of Dyer Pond Road. I think that's a little Dyer Pond.
Yeah, that's the minute. That's a copy. Okay.
I think that's good enough. Is there any more correspondence to come before us? If not, I'd just like to make a brief comment before we start. It is those of us on the planning board who do work with staff know the high quality of our staff, but I would like to draw your attention, particularly to those members who are in the public and perhaps are watching on TV, to the recent appointment of Mr. Jerry Daigle, who has been elected to the executive board of the International Board of Assessing Officials, and I think that's congratulations are in order. Under old business, you have in front of you a letter from Mr. Bruce requesting that the Gilcrest preliminary subdivision approval be withdrawn, and a motion would be in order, and I think you may have one in front of you, which would address that topic. If someone would like to make that motion.
I'll take a stab at it. Be it ordered that the request of Gilcrest Development Corporation / Brown Homes Inc. to withdraw without prejudice their applications for preliminary subdivision approval and a permit for wetlands alteration regarding the proposed Gilcrest Farm project be granted.
And a second? It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? They did not renew their option, and so this motion is in order. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? The motion is carried. Our next item of business is signing of a final plan of Spinnaker Heights. You recall that Spinnaker Heights was before us at the last board meeting, and there were a few things that needed to be put on the Mylar, and I think we are now up to snuff, are we?
Yes, we're up to snuff. The changes have been made on the Mylar, and in addition, the Model D that was required as part of the condition has also been submitted and met with Tom Leahy's approval. And there's a copy of that in the materials that were handed out tonight. And so I think the plan is pretty much ready for the board to sign it per the approval of the last meeting. Just so you know, once you sign it, Jerry Daigle will be holding it until Mr. McGovern has a chance to the next day sign the easement. The easement agreement that was made between the applicant and the town, and once the land trust has also signed their easement, things will be definitely complete, and the Mylar will be able to be released to the applicant. So, things are ready to go.
Is there a representative here?
We have the Mylar here, and I think there is a representative.
Just want to indicate that the signed copy is here.
Mr. Daigle has the signed copy. The rest of you like to exercise your feet in your hands? Spinnaker Heights subdivision plan has now been signed and awaits further treatment in the town office. Our last item of old business is the Maxwell Farm Market, and this is coming in for a site plan review under section 19-2-9. And I think Mr. Maxwell said that one of his presenters may have a time restraint, so we may do a little reversal of the procedure. But Mr. Maxwell, did you have a different order in which you wanted to present?
Well, I'd like to deal with the traffic situation first, because the traffic engineer would like to leave as soon as possible. So we can put the most recent picture up here of it, of the general layout. Looks pretty. I don't know if we'll sell any more corn or not. Looks good. I think you know who I am, and Mr. Maxwell, and we've been before you before. We do have William Ray here, and I know he's no stranger to you either, and he's prepared this traffic engineer's report. I asked him if he had to tell everything that I'd done the last 5 years over our present market, but he doesn't build at all. And he'll mention this with the fact that I don't expect to be as large when I open this one as I am after 15 years with the other one, and yet I will confess that I'm not going to build that building with the idea of sitting there twiddling my thumbs. So I think he's addressed the traffic with all maximum possibility problems. And I'll let him come and answer your questions and explain it to you.
Do you want to step up to the...
Mr. Bray.
Good evening. I just would try to respond to any questions that the board may have.
Are there any questions of planning board members? I was rather surprised at your in your estimates of and the fact that they seem to conclude that you would not need a signalization of the intersection of Spurwink and Route 77. Do you want to just elaborate on how you would justify that that conclusion?
Yes, ma'am. The manual on uniform traffic control devices, which is the information that's used by state and federal transportation officials to determine if traffic signals are warranted at any intersection, have 11 warrants in that manual whereby you can examine existing or projected roadway conditions and determine if traffic signals are warranted. The one that best applies to the Spurwink Route 77 intersection would be the warrant 2, which is indicated in the report, which is the interruption of continuous traffic along that major arterial. And as I've indicated in the report, you have to have a minimum of 750 vehicles for 8 hours of an average day of a year on the major arterial and 75 vehicles on the higher approach of the minor arterial. And as indicated in the report in the table of the information that was collected, the traffic volumes on Route 77 and actually on Spurwink do not meet the minimum threshold values for those signals at this point. So even if I were to recommend them, the DOT in all likelihood would not approve them because they have not met the minimum threshold values. All I can do is either recommend for or against, and the town would have to make a formal application to the state, and the state would review those signal warrants the same as I have done here, and I would trust that they would make the same conclusion that I've
reached. So it is the state who would make that final.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And on page 6, where you do discuss the level of service, you pointed out that the left-hand turn through the right turn is a D service, which is a long delay, and I should have taken number one first, that the left turn through the right turn on Spurwink Avenue eastbound is a very long delay. Is that a concern safety-wise?
Not in all honesty, because you could measure probably any roadway, minor roadway along Route 77 during the evening rush hour and draw the same conclusion. Typically on minor roadways crossing an arterial during the either morning rush hour or the evening rush hour, the side street traffic is delayed because of that volume of volume on the major arterial. And again, keeping in mind that these numbers are based on a computer model, and the sensitivity of any model is, you know, adaptable to national trends and not necessarily trends typical in the town of Cape Elizabeth. So if you went out there and actually measured the available gaps in the traffic stream, we probably would come up with a different result that would indicate probably something slightly better than what's shown here. But again, these numbers are based on the accepted computer model that's used universally to analyze traffic. It's a lengthy answer, but I wanted to make sure that you understood the rational pattern that we try to go through in determining that.
Thank you.
Is this on now? I don't know whether it's on or off. You used Portland projections or Portland statistics from a farm store in Portland to project Cape Elizabeth traffic. Is that right?
That's correct. I used Mr. Maxwell's store in Allen's Corner in Portland, again trying to develop the very worst possible case of traffic generation, at least in my opinion and in Mr. Maxwell's opinion, that could result from this farm stand.
Do you say that's worse just because there are more people in Portland who are likely to be customers? I guess what I'm getting at is if for some reason the traffic or the number of customers is radically different, that would go to a farm stand in in Cape Elizabeth as opposed to Portland, and obviously your traffic analysis is off. So I'm interested in why you feel that the Portland numbers are conservative for Cape Elizabeth.
Okay, I try to answer that in two different ways. First of all, I think the market in the city of Portland, in the greater Portland area, because both of those arterials that cross at the location of the store in Portland are certainly commuter arterials as well as local feeder roads in the city. So the availability of that store to a greater market is certainly there. The other thing that I've tried to point out in the report, at least in my opinion, I'm very conservatively estimated that only 25% of the total generation by the food stand would be diverted from the existing traffic stream, or in other words, somebody that's already on the roadway today. So what I'm saying is that this store will generate 75% of its trips will be new trips to the roadway. I think there would be a real good argument, although very difficult to prove probably one way or the other, that a greater percentage of traffic probably in the evening rush hour would be diverted from the existing traffic stream that's out there today. Someone coming home from work, stopping to pick up a dozen ears of corn or a couple pounds of tomatoes or whatever, there would be a great demand for that in the evening hour, and I've only estimated that at 25%.
Mrs. Guthrie.
Madam Chairman, it does seem like a very honest report to me, too. I think I had a couple of concerns on page 2 of your report. You mentioned that the total number of accidents between 1985 and 87 was 7. Do you have any idea when you investigated those accidents, did they take place at the intersection during these peak hour periods?
I do not have that information available. All I asked for in this particular case was a computer printout from the Accident Bureau in Augusta, and it shows 6 accidents occurring at the intersection. It's something that could be readily obtained, yes. But it was not obtained in this case.
Well, I think the local police department has all of the statistics, you know, relating to accidents, because I think I was a little concerned that 8 or more is considered very risky, and you're showing 7.
Yeah, I'm showing 6, and maybe I didn't explain the narrative portion of it underneath of that table. Mm-hmm. You need to have 8 at a given location.
Oh, I see.
And I've shown 2 locations there, so yes, there's still 6 accidents,
right.
But there isn't 7, so there is 6, 3/4 of what the minimum threshold value for a high accident location defined by MDOT.
Mm-hmm. And one more thing, Mr. Gray, on page 8, under number 4, you honestly admit that there will be a considerable delay experienced by the left-turning traffic from Spurlink Avenue. How about left-turning traffic going north on Route 77? And how would that interfere with the flow of traffic going into Portland at peak hours?
Okay, the left turn from inbound Route 77, because of the overall width of Route 77, that left-turning vehicle could, exercising good driver judgment, would hug to the double yellow center line of the roadway, and there would be sufficient room on the right of that vehicle for a through vehicle to pass. And I think if you look at the capacity analysis in table, I have to make sure that I tell you the right table. The capacity analysis indicates that the left turn from Route 77 into Spurlink would operate at the highest level of service.
Right.
And based on my field observations during the peak hour, I never at any time observed more than one vehicle waiting to make that left turn, which would indicate a very high level of service does exist out there on Route 77.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Gray.
Yes, ma'am.
Are there any other questions or comments? Mrs.
Guthrie, did you feel that you would like information from our own police department?
It might be a good idea since it seems to be an accident prone area between 1985 and 87 anyway. I don't know about recently. But, you know, if others feel that that isn't necessary, I certainly wouldn't press for that.
How do the rest of you feel on that matter?
Madam Chairman, I guess the thought I'd have is that the police and fire departments review our site plan proposals, and that may be a question that staff would want to direct to the police chief and that staff review, and if it's appropriate, getting comments back. Otherwise, I think the data was presented was very complete and very professionally done.
Are there any other questions, Mr. Bride, before we release him?
I can wait a few minutes. Anyways, I don't have to go precisely this moment.
All right. Fine. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And
thank you.
Good report.
Perhaps just a comment, perhaps in the answer to Mr. Box's question. I think anybody going into business like this, the customer acceptance is unknown. And one thing we're doing that we absolutely shouldn't do is put a business next to the Atlantic Ocean, and we can't get many customers from out there. But we're banking on the town of Cape Elizabeth to watch these grow, to be a ready customer. And we do expect traffic to come out from South Poland. And I can think of no better place in the Cape where I could have it, where I could create less of a problem to my neighbors than where it is now. Where we are in Portland, we get a lot of customers as far as Freeport and Brunswick and these type of places that come down through and go to the main mall or whatever brings them in. We've had customers say that when they have guests, they bring them to Maxwell's Farm Market first and then to L.L. Bean's. I don't think that's very often, but it's nice of them to say it. So I don't know if that answered your question, but we do have a very successful location over there. We're being squeezed. We're losing our parking and a few other things. But as far as customers in the area, we're surrounded by them. So just a comment there. So we do have Steve Doe here, Sebago Technics, who can start in square one wherever you want to and kind of deal with one step at a time. We've just quickly seen the checklist from Steve Butler.
You do have a copy of the checklist.
Yes, I just got it a few minutes ago, and I know he can comment on some of those and go as you
wish. Thank you. Doe.
Like Ken said, my name is Steve Doe. I am from Sebago Technics, landscape architect with the company. And I suppose, would you like me to go through the site plan and explain anything to you? Would you like to go ask questions? Or
I think it would be helpful if you could just give an overall view of the plan for the benefit of not only the planning board, but those who are here in the audience.
Okay.
Madam Chairman, before he starts, have they had the opportunity to review Mr. Hunter's letter that talked about the analysis that he had made?
No, I don't believe. That just arrived on our desk.
I reviewed it.
Have you had a chance?
Yeah, I just got it and have reviewed it.
You have reviewed it.
Yeah.
You might want to particularly address some of the questions that Bob Hunter raises in his letter.
Good point.
Okay, just to give you a general view of the site. Mr. Maxwell owns roughly 10-acre parcel on Berwick Avenue, 377, would be in this direction. And this section of the parcel is high ground. Basically, the site sits on a knoll, and the land slopes away from it in all directions. And an amended section on farm markets, section 19.2.2, Residence A district, called for a 100-foot setback on farm markets and a 50-foot setback on parking lots. And we were following that, the front of the building being at the 100-foot setback and the parking lot being at the 50-foot setback. side yard setbacks, I believe, are 50 feet, and we are well over 200 feet in either direction. The way the site works, we're having one entrance and two exits, which is recommended by Bill Gray in his traffic study. Parking. Required parking is 39 spaces. We are proposing 41, so we have two spaces more than required. The back part of the parcel will be for overflow parking. This area from here to the rear of the building will be all gravel. We have two loading docks on the side here. In terms of addressing a question by Robert Hunter in terms of allowing for an SU-30 vehicle. We have not allowed for an SU-30 vehicle, which is basically a semi.
Excuse me, could you explain what an SU-30 vehicle is?
Okay.
We've all been puzzled.
Okay, that is a semi. Semi vehicle. Tractor trailer.
Tractor trailer.
Okay, and tractor trailer has requirements for getting in and out, turning radiuses. We have allowed for an SU-30 vehicle, but we have not allowed for it to get to the loading dock. We are planning on just unloading it in this front parking area here. The tractor will come in, down the entrance, pull into this location. I don't know if you can see this. Okay. The truck will come in this location and pull in over here. Then it will back up, and then it will be loaded across the sidewalk. Then it will continue to back up and then go out in this direction.
So we don't anticipate tractor trailer trucks. It would be just for a rare one a year or two a year or something like that. So we had to let them get off the street, but we don't plan on regular delivery.
And then his first concern, that was his, actually that was his third concern, in regards to stormwater runoff, we are allowing for two methods. One is to tie into an existing storm drain that runs along or through Maxwell's Field, and which will end up into his irrigation pond before running into the brook. So all the water will either travel that route or sheet flow across the site. And that water going to the irrigation pond will also be used back on his field. So that's how we address that concern. Running down the list here, the site plan review submission checklist. I guess any of the questions you have on that, I would address at this time.
Just to bring things all up to speed, mm-hmm. We should have the names of the owners of all the contiguous land.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We have that. It is not on the plan. It is on a separate sheet, which I can transfer onto the sheet.
It would be helpful to see.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can do that.
And, yes, Mr. Butler.
If I may just ask, the separate sheet, has that been submitted to the planning board?
I believe it has. It's an 8.5 by 11 sheet. Dated September 30th, 1988. I have a copy of it if you'd like to.
Do the rest of you have a copy of this?
No. Didn't make it in any of our packets.
The whole package. He's got one copy, that's all. Didn't know if we needed it on the sheet or not, but we did put it on the sheet.
It would be helpful to have it put on the sheet.
We can add it to the sheet.
So if you can do that, apparently we don't seem to have it in our package. It just hasn't been distributed.
Oh, okay.
But we would like it.
I still will add it to the sheet.
That would be helpful.
Could you comment perhaps on the parking spaces, the proposed parking spaces? I know that, you've said that you've allowed for 41.
Right.
Is there an explanation as to why you need that? You feel that many are needed?
No, I guess there really wasn't a set reason why we picked 41 as opposed to 40 or 39. In terms of the engineering and the actual layout, we came up with 41. You know, we could have taken two off, but the engineering, the actual the geometrics of the site works better with 41.
It seems like a lot of parking spaces for the area for cars bumping in and out. But you must have some.
Well, one thing that we were very concerned of, dealing with traffic, that we would have a parking place so that when a person swung in off the road, they would be a parking place available. So that there, even though we're 50 feet from the road, which I think it actually would solve the problem, we wanted to do two things. One is a lot of our customers are elderly. We wanted quite a lot of parking near the entrance. So we started in the first with just a single row out front. And that means that most of the parking would be way off to the end somewhere. So then we doubled it, made two rows in the front. Okay. Follow it here now. Well, it's only one row right here, but right on either side. We have doubled that. So, you know, I've even asked him where he got the requirement so many spaces, because going by everything I've read, we only need 10 or a dozen. Okay. But, because a lot of these employees parking down back would be employees and who knows
and
what
how
else.
How many employees did you anticipate at a time?
All we can do is go on a present one, and I will look back here. Maximum employees over
at one time.
Mm-hmm. So to have that, and you know, and of course in the rear it's going to be a lot of farm work being done as that's adjacent to our field. You know, a lot of our stuff will be coming in that way, so we wanted to have plenty of parking out front so that anybody that come in could immediately get off the road. Mm-hmm. And so maybe a little overkill, but that was our desire.
Are there any other questions about the site plan? Yes.
Madam Chairman, you mentioned on the drainage, mm-hmm. when you addressed it, that the water would flow into the brook. Which brook are you referring to?
That is
Trout Brook.
Right. We'll end up into the Trout Brook watershed. So it flows from the site into the pipe or across the field into Maxwell's irrigation pond, and then from that point into Trout Brook.
The irrigation pond has always flowed into Trout Brook?
Yes.
How many square feet of impervious surface or paving are you going to have in this project?
Okay, I don't have the answer for that.
Because you seem to be getting close to the 10,000 square feet of paving on this project. I just quickly measured it with a ruler.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I could. I don't have the figures with me now, but I could.
If you would, please.
Yes.
If I'd just like to clarify whether or not the applicant's proposing to do a stormwater analysis or not.
We had worked on a stormwater erosion control plan, but not really the management, assuming that the water would end up in the irrigation pond and from that point would be used in the field irrigation.
And according to our ordinance, if we do have over 10,000 square feet of surface,
it will be
which
required.
I think we just need that.
Okay.
Any other comments or questions?
Madam Chairman, in our checklist there are a number of issues that are indicated as being partial or no indication of whether it's been satisfied as far as the submissions. And if the applicant could go down over that checklist and deal with those issues and indicate whether there's information to be coming or whether or not they feel that the information is satisfied on the plan, that would be of use.
Could you?
Sure. First one is building plans and elevations. Apparently we had not submitted elevations. We do have elevations submitted. Oh, okay. I do have some building plans and elevations. I have not submitted them. They were prepared by another company, but I do have those today if you would like to look at those. And I can also submit those as well. 3C, names of all owners, of the owners of all contiguous lands. We have addressed that already. Lot line dimensions. Those dimensions are shown on the project boundary plan. We have given the dimensions in all corners. It's located down the left-hand corner of the site plan.
And it's usually shown on the plan itself, given the fact that we're talking about a large parcel. I just wanted to raise the issue to the board, and it may not be absolutely necessary.
Okay.
If you're going to confine things to the small space.
Item 7, building setback, sideline, and rear yard distance. We have showed the parking setback and the 100-foot building setback. We have not showed the side or the rear yard because they would be located. It's confined to this. It'd be located on this locus, which we well exceed those anyway. We're well over 200 feet, which the side and rear is 50 feet.
Madam Chairman, maybe the applicant has a different list than I do, but there were some blanks above there.
Oh.
Example, location of any easement.
I think he was tackling just the parcels and he didn't leave the
Yeah, I was not aware that whether we met all those, the blank ones, whether we did not need those. Or
blank means either a big question or you haven't met them as far as I could tell.
Okay.
So going back perhaps to 5A.
Okay. There are no existing buildings or structures except for a telephone pole and a fire hydrant. Mm-hmm. Location of easements, not aware of any easements.
There are no existing easements on the property.
Not that we were aware of. Mm-hmm. Location of driveways, there are none.
Madam Chair, if I can go back. The reason why I had a question about the easements, I saw the existing storm sewer line. I just wanted to see
whether that is an easement or
whether
not.
Whether that's covered under an easement or not.
I believe you had installed it.
No, that's green. Always been there, and our dad to put up with Canterbury Hill and everything else coming in from there. And so, whether there's still volume, nothing that we need to use it, I'm not sure. But after they get through, but if there isn't, I'll just go up the private drain back to the top. It's just a fine, flat rock drain. That's above where I was talking to you. When they rebuilt Sperling Avenue, it always ran into that. But when they rebuilt Sperling Cavanaugh, they wouldn't do it. And I said, boy, you're going to. It's not going right out on top of my field. And finally, what he did, he connected into it and then left the blow-off up above so if the drain didn't handle it, it would grow on the top. And I've never seen a drop of water grow there. So those farmers back then knew what they were doing. I have rebuilt the lower half of the concrete drain, and that's where I'll be tying into it now.
Thank you.
And Chairman, considering that the driveway, the requirements are those on the site within 100 feet, I think it'd be beneficial for the board to know where the properties across the street,
where the driveways
are, so they have a general idea in terms of how many access points on and off of Sperling there might be.
Okay. That would also fall under location of entrances and exits.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 6C, proposed roads. not epical, I assume. 8A, all existing physical features on the site and within 200 feet thereof. Within 200 feet, it is all basically farmland of Maxwell's Farm. Are you talking outside the locus of the site?
There are no mountains or...
No mountains.
Outstanding waterfalls or...
No. The high-intensity soil survey is required. Would that be required?
Probably not.
Okay.
But I think it's important to see your stormwater runoff.
Okay. 11A, road information, again, assume not applicable. 11B, curb information. There is no curbing. We are not proposing any curbing. There is no existing curbing on Spurwink.
And again, if the stormwater plan...
Might require that.
Might. Okay. That's essential to...
Okay.
Can I ask a question about the high-intensity soil survey?
Mm-hmm.
My old discussion with Mr. Tinsman here convinced me that the only reason you'd need it is if there's going to be on-site waste disposal.
Correct.
I don't recall when I looked through the package seeing whether people are going to have a septic tank or what you're going to do with that.
Okay, this will be on public sewer and public water.
Okay.
So we'll be tying it over.
Is there going to be a foundation of this building?
Yes, it will. It will be a... I don't know if you read the drawings, but there'll be a basement elevation, which this gravel area back here will access the basement. So it will be basically a two-story building from the rear and a one-story building viewing it from Spurwink.
Okay. When I looked at the at the diagram, it didn't look like there would be, but what you're saying is it's basically a daylight basement.
Right.
Madam Chairman, going on to just for a second on the water, public water, probably would need a letter from the Portland Water District saying that
okay.
Adequate to their system. In terms of the public sewer, I guess we need to double check that with the town staff. Again, both of these probably should be in some sort of written communication so
okay.
We know that that's what you're proposing. Going back to natural features under 8A, I just wanted to ask the board if they thought they wanted to at least see some basic soils information which could be provided by a medium intensity soil survey, which would really be taken off of the Cumberland County Soil Survey. That's one thing that's required there. Again, high intensity soil survey doesn't seem really necessary here. I just want to ask whether or not you want to have some basic soils information or not.
It is readily available. I can get the information.
I think it might be help round out the package.
Okay. Location, design of existing and proposed stormwater systems. We've addressed that. Location, design of sanitary
wind. Chairman, sorry.
No, sorry.
I hate to keep on doing it. I think even if you're not proposing a full-fledged stormwater analysis,
mm-hmm.
you might want to show a little more in terms of the stormwater flows,
okay.
the drainage that's going to occur. You show it somewhat on the plans, but
mm-hmm.
it's not a lot of detail. At least perhaps showing where the water is going to be originating from, how
okay.
what you're going to do to cause it to sheet off in a certain direction and where it's going to go in terms of natural swales or what have you.
Okay.
That might be helpful, I think, if you don't have to go to that point where you have to do more detailed study.
And you are on public sewer.
Mm-hmm. So you're looking for a letter there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 12C, location design of portable water supply, potable water supply. We'll be on public water, so we'll get a letter on that. 12D, location design and methods of solid waste storage and disposal. We're assuming that will be by, I guess, Mr. Max, would you be able to, in terms of solid waste disposal?
probably be doing your...
There'll be nothing other than the disposal of lettuce leaves and those things which will be going back on our field.
You recycle.
We do what we can. It's going to be a lot easier when we come out here and get nearer the field. Mm.
There won't be any dumpster around the outside of this facility. Will you be placing a dumpster there?
No, we don't anticipate anything in the exterior. This is one thing that we were well trained in Portland. We had absolutely no rear where we could hide anything, no pile of crates or trash or junk or anything. And all the trash was removed every day and controlled, and we anticipate the same thing here. Now, sure, there's going to be a little farm work going on, and there might be a tractor park there, but once in a while. But as far as the dumpster and that type, we don't anticipate anything.
But you wouldn't have anything like a lot of cartons around?
Well, not in relation to the market. Mm-hmm. You see, because there's times I have cartons there now when I'm harvesting and things like that. But mm-hmm. as far as with the market, everything will be going inside and undercover, Lord willing.
Question on the lighting detail. Notice you've got non-glare lights, two of them in the front, and you've got four trees, large trees?
Correct. Large shade trees, sugar maple.
Sugar maple. I guess the question I have is, will those lights be impacting the houses across the street?
No, that's what I mean when I mentioned the non-glare. What they will be is basically a box, what they call a shoebox light, and the light will be blocked from basically the parking lot towards the street, and the light will be thrown towards the parking lot in the building.
If that's where I put partial, that's sort of information that would be helpful, I think, for the board to see. So okay. I can see exactly what's going to be provided. Something, a detail more than just light on.
Madam Chairman, if we could have a lighting footprint plan, I think that would be important, particularly in a residential area. The lumens all the way around.
There are a couple of questions on the sign. Do you have a sign plan, or is there going to be a sign on the road or on the building? How are you going to handle that?
There will be a sign which we're going to locate in the island here.
Mm-hmm. Shown on the plane.
Oh, there we are. Okay.
Yeah. All the nice trees of the garage.
That's why we're rewriting that one.
Because we wanted, letters on the building, but 100 feet away with trees in front of it. So
that would be a
tree mass for that. So we're going to put just 1x4 just along.
And it wouldn't be a light over it or a shield?
This is what he shows on here, just a line on each side of it.
Little light.
They'd like the people to know what they were.
Right.
Again, the board may want to have a detail in terms of what the sign's actually going to look like.
Okay.
Looks like.
If we can go backwards again, I know it says okay under the landscaping and buffering plan. Do you feel that the four sugar maples, I mean a maple of substantial size has quite a, can go 6 to 8 feet before it starts to leaf? Mm-hmm. And do you feel that that's adequate buffer from across the street or neighbors who would be, is there, do you feel there might be any need for low shrubs to add to the buffering?
Right now, the land is all open. The existing condition is all open. It's either farmland. The building is not really objectionable in terms of the architecture, that it really needs to be screened, per se. In terms of buffering.
I'm thinking of headlights, for example, coming out that.
Out of the project?
A low shrubbery hedge or something.
Okay, most of the, I don't know where you get the headlight. The headlights were basically, when they exit the property,
right,
would be shining like directly across the street.
And that wouldn't interfere too much with.
There was a driveway there, but there was no.
But headlights in the parking area.
Right, as they pull into the lot, mm-hmm. I believe this is wooded along here anyway. Mr. Maxwell, you're familiar with that more existing condition.
The only place I can see any real problems here is that they were driving right straight out, and you couldn't do anything there. Now, as they're approaching the exit and swinging, it's not going to take much there to cover the headlights. We're going to be going downhill. Mm-hmm. The area next to the road would be the highest, and almost anything there would be up above the headlights until they start going out at the exit road.
Madam
Chairman.
Yes. Of course, something could be said about the importance of hiding the parking lot. So would you give consideration to extending the evergreens, which are on the side, to the front there? I mean, you could really have both. I think the idea of the sugar maples is that's very gracious. On the other hand, they are not going to hide the parking lot, which would be a concern for me if I lived in the neighborhood. That's a change from the beautiful open space. So, you know, I think that it would be a very excellent plan if the evergreens were brought over to the front of the area so that all of the cars would also be screened.
We would want to be careful that we didn't screen it so the building was completely hid.
Mm-hmm.
So what you can require to hide a car.
Right.
Not completely hide the building.
Right. Mm-hmm. I can understand that.
I think it would be a compromise to
right.
break up the parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
And whether this is enough or a one or two of the thoughtful in between to add to it.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman, if people go to the site just before L.L. Bean, they'll know where it is, regardless of whether it's hidden by shrubbery or not.
Do we want to turn Cape Elizabeth into another free port?
Serious question. And the last item, evidence of right title and interest in property, we just need to complete the package.
Okay.
I hope that perhaps this gives you a feel for some of the items that we need more detail mm-hmm. on, the lighting, the buffering, the stormwater runoff, and a little better delineation of the butters and, mm-hmm. and such features
sure.
such as that. Are there any other comments or questions? I think we might like to go and see this site. Would the rest of the planning board
yeah.
feel that that would be, perhaps we could set a date with you to do that. Would this coming weekend be too soon on a Saturday? Would this coming weekend be too soon on a Saturday?
Sorry.
Oh, it's fine.
9 o'clock, leisurely enough. All right, but would that be agreeable with you?
9 o'clock.
Fine, let's make a date for 9 o'clock Saturday the 22nd. For site visit, and this will give us a better feel for the whole location too. Are there any other questions?
Well, we do have a representative of Roki Associates who are responsible, we feel, to build the building, and he can pretty well speak, I think, to the measurements of the heights of some of these things, even though they aren't designated and you've requested them. So if you have any questions from him, he is here. And that's the other plan that he's saying in.
I think it would be helpful to know the total square footage. Is that on the...
I believe it's on the site plan, under general notes.
On the site plan, yeah.
It's 55 and by 40 is what we've got, although we have included on the side, and whether you want to deal with that and have us worrying about it,
a future greenhouse type thing that we put on the bubble there.
The 12 by 28.
Right. We're not sure what that will be. We're not sure whether we want to include it now. But the idea was not to grow things, but to have a place where we can
sell plants.
Yes, sell plants in the spring. We sell seedlings, the things we grow ourselves. And he has a struggle now. He has to put grow lights over them. They turn yellow in a week, and I have to bring them back and rejuvenate them again. So we're thinking that this would make a great asset, and yet he could also use it later
and you
on.
You have a written guarantee that these would be super super plants. So
I let him try to snow the customers on that stuff. How's that? And on that stormwater situation, I know he'll bring in what you need technically to be correct, but I want you to know that, see, that water is going to go across my field. Like the water that comes off from Spilling Calvin or the water that comes off from any other construction. And if I'm going to use those fields, I have to deal with it. And if I create a problem, I'm going to have to take my backhoe and put in a larger pipe and do this and do that. And so I don't know if that satisfies you, but I am not going to destroy an acre to a field just to provide drainage for that parking lot, regardless whether it's 5,000 square feet or 10,000. That land is very precious to me. It's been that way all my life. And what's near the market is going to be extra precious because we hope to have flowers around there and those type of things. That'll be a general asset to the whole situation. So from my heart to you is I'll take care of that storm drainage because it's going to kill me if I don't. But I know he'll have
but
to...
But just to meet the letter of the
right.
Amendment, if we can have that in
what I've got him here for.
Good.
One final comment is that if you're planning on being on the November agenda, the submission deadline would be October 28th.
Okay. Do you have any questions for Mr. Roque, or are you...
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Tinsley.
It really wasn't a final comment, but I've still got a couple of questions. And they relate to the process that we're in. And if Mr. Maxwell could spend a few moments talking about the Zoning Board of Appeals and where we are in that whole process, the pending lawsuit against, I believe, the town. I'm not sure.
And do you all have copies of that or
no of that? No, I've had no copies. But if you could address that. I also heard reference to a draft of a zoning ordinance change that this planning board considered, on which Mr. Maxwell sat on the committee that recommended it to the planning board, that now the planning board has recommended to the council and is under consideration. There was reference to that this evening and how that fits into his plans. It was a brief mention of that draft ordinance, which has not been adopted, is not in effect yet. And the third comment relates, those two are questions. The third comment, though, is that I think everyone appreciates that from your heart to our ordinances that you're going to take care of the stormwater issues. We still, though, have ordinances that I think we have to maintain, and those ordinances require a stormwater management plan to be prepared so that as you're out there fixing up the situation, we'll have reviewed that before you're fixing it up and understand what you propose to do. So I would expect with our ordinances where 10,000 square feet will be disturbed that a stormwater management plan has to be prepared. We will have to review it, and then you will have to live by that. That's on the same basis that all of those subdivisions that you talked about this evening affecting you are also reviewed by this planning board, and very careful attention, as you know, having been an abutter to some of those and having to write letters in support or not in objection to those developments were very important to the planning board. That's part of it, and the other part is the technical review that has to occur. So I would expect that it would be more formal than if there's a problem to be taken care of.
That's what I've got him here for. So.
Good. Mm-hmm. Good.
Now, who can tackle first?
Okay, what was the first one you started in on? Well, on March 22nd, I appeared before you. That was in 1988. That's where it started, and I came for a pre-conference plan and showed you a few pretty pictures and things, and some said they liked it, but they didn't give me anything. So the next thing I went to was the zoning board. They didn't know what to do with me at first, but they found out they couldn't get rid of me. And the reason I went to them was because I couldn't come to do what I wanted to do under the roadside stand. That would have merely meant site plan review, and I could have gone ahead and proceeded with it, but I could have only, by the letter of the law, sold only what I grew myself. I couldn't even buy from my neighbor, from across the street, or from anyone else if I was to be technically obedient to the law. And wanting to come in the front door, I said, I can't live that way. I'm not going to build a roadside market and then proceed to do what I want to afterwards. So I did go to the zoning board to try to get them to grant an accessory use, or however you want to word it, to allow me to sell other than what I grew myself. We gave them the figures of what we do at our own market, and it was a challenge, and it was new ground that they'd never plowed before. But the end result was that they did grant it to me. I haven't got the details right here. I've got it back there, but I can sell 40% of body and stuff, and I got a certain amount can be allied. I don't know, they wooded it there, or preserves, or something like that. And they put in times of closing and some of these things. But they did grant it, and one of their requirements was that I come before you, because I'm a lonely child now at this case. I'm not a roadside stand. I'm an individual now. And so they knew that if they didn't require that or get me to be willing to accept it, I could just go get my building permit. So they did ask me to do that, and so now I'm here. There is a lawsuit against the zoning board endeavoring to turn around, or however you want to call it, their decision that is still pending in court. I know that's there, and if that is successful, there could be some questions of whether I'm legally here before you now. But I'm here before you out of one of three possibilities. I would eventually come under what the town council is working on if I had to wait that long. If that was seen forever, I would turn around and come to you as a roadside market and then handle the rest when it came, or I'm going to come to you under the zoning board. But I feel as though that if we address it, and we get it behind us, even if the technicalities come up, when the technicalities are taken care of, we will have 90% of our work done, and we'd ought to be able to slide downhill from there. So maybe I'm wrong in my picturesque picture of it, but that's the way I see it.
And I believe that the town ordinance committee is going to be having a meeting on the farm stand, the market stand, which you might be interested in going to also, which will be on November 7th, and it's at 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
I think that's my fourth meeting that night, and I will be out of the country at that time, so that's a...
Well,
going
to
make it.
To
I appreciate
what
that.
The progress
right,
is.
Right.
And I'm sure that the chairman of the ordinance committee from the planning board, will try to be there. So.
Yeah, well, I'd love to be there, and I don't know if I can bend something or not. But I have spoken to it several times, and as Mr. Tinsman razzed me, says Mr. Maxwell's never lost for words. You know, he always wants to say something. And they know my viewpoints, and I think it's very important in that it does deal at least somewhat with the preservation of open space.
Mm-hmm.
Just a quick comment, not a last comment, is that the town, I checked with the town attorney, and he said that it was proper for the planning board to be going through the site plan review process, even though the matter was up in the courts, and that once that issue was decided one way or another, then we'd come back and decide where to go next. So at this point, We're okay to go ahead.
I figure we've had a profitable meeting tonight, and regardless of when I come back, we'll have this much behind us. But I intend to be back next meeting.
The second part of my question was, your consultants have referred to standards that are not yet ordinances, and the purpose of the question was to see if there are any standards in our existing ordinance, or whether you are reaching to the proposed standards where none exist in our existing and attempting to meet something that might be adopted in the future?
Well, you and I were there and we batted around those things and I think both of us agreed to them, so I suppose if I agreed to them, I'd ought to figure what's good for the goose is good for the gander. It would be one way for me to look at it. A lot of these setbacks and things are not legal requirements at this time. You could require them, perhaps, but they're not in the ordinance. But I have volunteered them to go that way. The 100-foot setback seems a long ways away from the street to me, but I think it's things that we can live with, give extra buffering and extra chance for shrubbery and all these type of things. So I have not seen anything there that, you know, it just make it ridiculous to live with. I realize that, we were there in the discussion of it, that we're in the residential zone. I'm a little more fortunate because I do not have abutters squeezing me on each side. We're requiring 40,000 square feet, and of course I've got, yay, 3-4 times that amount. But I still appreciate the intention of that law to respect the residential area, so I've been willing and agreeable to include that in. I don't know if that...
Oh, that's very helpful to hear your point of view on that, and I think that the planning board is appreciative of the fact that this is in a residential zone, right, and that our farmland is scarcer and scarcer and near a rarity. We want to encourage that kind of occupation in the town, but we do also want to make sure that we have laws that make it happy for everybody to live
right
together.
Right. Mr. Tinsmill, not deal with it approximately?
Very well.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I presume that we take some action, and I presume that a motion to table would be in order pending receipt of additional data to make the application complete.
I'm not sure that, I mean, this is under a site plan review that we technically have to have completed application, so I think the motion to the table is in order. Someone would like to do that, unless there are other comments or questions.
Are we going to be closing the activity on this application? I mean, why would we have to table? Why can't we keep it open? We're going for a site review, a site visit.
I think that would be the mechanism to get it to the next meeting.
To get it to the next meeting? Okay.
That's the sole attempt at that.
I would let you know that we are going to have Robert's Rules of Order newly revised right beside us in case we need future guidance. We've asked for that in the budget. But I do think...
I'm sure you'll find them in there.
Our legal counsel or a lawyer on our planning board. Would someone like to make that motion to table?
It was made.
It's been moved. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Carried. And we'll look forward to it.
Was that tabled to the next meeting or tabled forever?
No.
The motion read was spoken anyway that it would be tabled pending receipt of the data that we talked about this evening. If you can get it in for the next meeting, then presumably that's what would be on the agenda.
Fine. Fair enough.
Thank you very much for your presentation, and we have an item of new business next, and we're 20 minutes behind, but we have a very light agenda this evening, so Mr. Cowan is coming in for a public access waiver on Alexander Road off from Eastman Road. Cowan is here himself. Mr. Cowan, we have, the planning board has some
sketches
of your proposed plan for a public access waiver,
right.
So if you could just give us a brief summary of what it is you want to do and what the situation is.
Okay, existing right now, we have, I should say we, there are three lots on Alexander Drive. Lot number one on one of your diagrams does have a house on it, which was built back in roughly 1983. I've gone to the town to get a building permit for my lot, which is lot number two, and they advised me that back in 1986, they had some changes as far as a private road was concerned. And meeting the requirements, basically, I met all the requirements prior to this session, except that I needed to put a 50-foot long by 22-foot wide paved apron on the end of the dirt road. I spoke with the Public Works Department, and they basically told me what I needed to do to meet the requirements, and also asked them if they had any comments about Alexander Drive, and basically the only comment they had was that he wasn't exactly sure from memory how the road approached Eastman Road as far as elevation and whether or not there was any water runoff or so on and so forth. There isn't. It's basically downhill to some small degree from Eastman Road, so there is no water runoff. We did put the pave apron in, and as far as I can tell, and speaking with the Public Works Department, we're all set. It was basically that one technicality.
Your driveway on the first now probably would hook on to this
right.
Driveway. If I think it would be helpful for us just to have this on one sheet, if you could do that.
Know
how we're hooked together here.
Yeah, well, basically, if you slide them together, they come right together. Alexander Drive comes down and then makes a hard right, and it goes from there, and that's basically it. The three lots are 1, 2, and 3 from the corner, so if you come straight down the road, you're basically looking at lot number 1, and then when you
coming
make that
down
right.
The road from Eastman.
Right. Mm-hmm. You take a left off of Eastman Road, if you came from Sawyer, onto Alexander Drive. And you come straight down for approximately, 300 feet. And then you make a right turn. And right there, as you make that right, is lot number one, which does have a house and a driveway on it. And then just beyond that is lot number two, which is the lot that I own that I'm applying for the waiver for so I can get a building permit. And then beyond that is lot number three. So they're all right in a row. And what we basically have, Alexander Drive, is a 50-foot easement, which is, I guess, exceeds the requirements that the town needs.
And you're going over a 50-foot easement, are you?
Yeah, we've got a 50-foot easement. I think the town requires 30 feet or something to that effect. So we meet that requirement without any problem.
You do not own lot number 3, or you?
No, my older brother owns lot number 1, and I own lot number 2 myself, and my younger brother owns lot number 3. So actually, this public access waiver will be for the benefits of lots number 2 and 3, whereas lot number 1 has already been built upon.
Mm. Well, I think that may be where we would run into a slight problem in that lot number 3, whoever ends up developing lot 3. Would have to come in also for public access waiver.
Okay. Well, the fact that
if we should grant public access,
okay,
waiver,
I see what
could
you're
not
saying.
Be carried over to lot 3.
Okay. Well, at this time, there is no concern for lot number 3. There are no intentions on building on it. It's basically for the purpose of lot number 2.
Mm-hmm. I guess I'm still having a little bit of a problem reading this plan right here. Is this the public access way we're looking for? This part right
it's
here?
It's that. It comes down that stretch, and then it goes directly 90 degrees from there towards Eastman Road. Basically what I did was I've submitted a plan to show the apron and the effects where it meets, where Alexander Drive meets Eastman Road, and then also the second plan, which you hold in your hand right now, is to show where the house would be situated on the lot in regards to Alexander Drive.
Mr. Cowan, how far back is, what would the distance be from Eastman Road back to where you show your driveway beginning?
Well, the main part of the road is, like I said, approximately 300 feet, roughly, from Eastman Road to the corner, and then goes up the corner probably another 200 feet. So, you know, if you drew a straight line, you'd have to go through actually someone else's property, but from where my driveway would connect to Alexander Drive, roughly 300 or 400 feet.
Are there any other questions or comments?
Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
I feel that I could maybe envision this better if we went to the site. I'd love to see it. And just one more question. Now, Weldon M. and Harriet M. McDonald do not use Alexander Drive.
No, they have direct
onto
access.
Eastman.
Right, there. Our road basically comes straight up about 300 feet and then hooks a hard right up to the three lots. You got lot one, lot two, and lot three directly in a row right at that corner.
Thank you.
And your father owns the lot adjacent to lot one, is that right?
He owns the bulk of the property adjacent to lot one, correct, up to and also abutting Eastman and Sawyer Road, with a small exception in the corner. There are three or four house lots there that are privately owned.
I agree. I think a site visit would be very helpful.
Madam Chairman, if I can back follow up on that, I was there at the site, in fact, this afternoon. And the actual road itself seems to be adequate. I mean, the roadway, the paved portion, in fact, is in. It's already been completed. The one issue, which was one which isn't apparent until you go out on the site, is the fact that there seems to be a slight sight distance problem when you're ready to come out to the entranceway. If you're coming out on Alexander Road and you stop and you want to look north to the right, up Eastman Road, there's a telephone pole and a lot of brush that really requires you to inch out into Eastman Road. So that's something I think the board would want to see and probably want to have some clearing done of the brush just to make sure that you'd have
that. Well, I spoke to Public Works and also Mr. Daigle, and basically the reaction I got was, as far as viewing distance up and down the road, town requires 10 miles. Actually, it's 10 miles per
correct.
10 feet for every mile per hour, which is basically a 25 zone, and we have in excess of that. We've got roughly 500 feet in either direction. There is a telephone pole right on the corner, a CMP pole, which we paved just as close as we could to make the apron. We had to meet a radius as far as the town was concerned, and we extended that out. The brush, from time to time, I've noticed the town does cut it in the summertime. Every once in a while, they come by with one of these side mowers and clips it. It's the type of brush that just keeps coming back. I mean, cut it and cut it and cut it, and it comes back. I don't know what could be done about it, to tell you the truth. If anybody had any suggestions, I'd be more than glad to listen.
I think it's either going to be, I think the planning board has to determine whether or not it's the town's responsibility or it's your responsibility to make sure the brush would cut back. So you wouldn't have, so you'd have adequate sight distance when you're back on Alexander Road. You know, just for safety.
Oh, yeah, I totally agree.
One other issue is, the question I had was whether or not you checked with the fire chief. And the reason I asked that is, in most public access waiver situations, we usually like to have some sort of turnaround provided, T-turnaround provided, so that if a fire truck or an ambulance has to go in to the access way, that has a way to kind of pull up and turn around without having to back out of public access.
I haven't spoken to the fire department myself about this particular instance. However, back in 1983, when my brother built, the main road that comes up off of Alexander, actually off of Eastman Road, before it makes that right there on the corner, there is a T for that purpose. Now, where the road makes the right and goes up the hill, the road actually goes beyond my lot to my brother's lot. At this time, it's not completely done. You know, the road is set sufficient to my lot. However, it does form a T right there, because it's going to continue when lot number three builds. So where my driveway comes off of that, there is a small T right there now. So we actually have two. We have one at the bottom of the hill right on the corner, and then we have one just actually beyond my driveway right there. So my driveway forms the T of the road.
And I think that's something we want to have the fire chief look at.
Perhaps give a letter just cooperating that this is adequate for safety.
Yeah.
At some point, the road becomes rather muddy, and you wouldn't want to have a fire truck stuck to it.
Yeah, no, I think
I think we're all in agreement that perhaps a sidewalk would be helpful, and we are planning a sidewalk already for Saturday morning, the 22nd. Would we be able to come and visit you perhaps around 9:45?
Fine.
Right. Take a look at that. So at 9:45, we'll come and see what.
That'll be fine.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Okay,
Cohen. Any other questions or comments before we?
So basically, in the meantime, I should contact the fire chief and have him come out.
If
and just
you
take
would
a look.
Just get his opinion and have a letter for us.
Okay.
That would be helpful.
The deadline is October 28th. So I'm assuming you're planning on coming back in November, and if so, you should just have that letter and other materials to us by the 20th of October.
Okay.
Thank you very much. We've set a new record tonight. Business by 8:30. However, we do have some other business, and if we can be very swift, perhaps we can have you home by 9:00. In your home, in your very home. You only have one access to your place. We have a November workshop that we had scheduled for the first Tuesday in November, and some of the outstanding issues that we have concern nursery daycare, the new wetlands ordinance, and the comprehensive a report from the comprehensive plan. And also, we have some patchwork that we are doing with the new subdivision ordinance, which already has a few things in there that we need to smooth out. One of them is our P's and Q's, which have to do with the dedication of land. And I think it might be helpful if we could, if you would take a look at P and Q, and I'm sorry I should have the exact ordinance for you.
P and Q.
So if you would look that over, just to bring you up to date, the town council made a point of clarification by adding the words in Q, in addition, the planning board shall require the subdivider. And the other thing that they did was to strike the word Cape Elizabeth Land Trust in O in the next last sentence, just to clarify the ordinance. So I think it would be helpful for us to have some discussion on that particular section, as well as the other sections of the subdivision ordinance that we talked about earlier. The wetlands ordinance probably will not be ready for our November meeting, and I'm sorry, Marion, I didn't have time to check with you today to see whether you've been able to do any further research on the nursery, and
I have an
expert now?
A number of pamphlets from the Department of Human Services. However, one pamphlet on the residential youth facilities, which I'm assuming has to do with private
private school. I have to get that elsewhere at a different department, so I'm dealing with that. I have three pamphlets, and unfortunately, on this one, which has to do with the home babysitting service, I have only one copy of that. So if the town could do that, and then there's another one on licensing and registration. So I have them all, and I would be happy to give out the pamphlets or just give them to you people. And when
if you could distribute them to Jane, perhaps she could
sure.
get them to us,
I'll
put this inside.
Well.
And then we will have a little reading period in November on daycare, nursery care, youth centers, and incorporate that whole gamut. I'd like to suggest that perhaps we skip a November workshop with the idea that we would be able to tackle the wetlands ordinance and have a report from the comprehensive plan, which by at that point Dan should be ready to give us a berth. Yes, well, at our workshop in December. Possibly. If we do, we may be able to tackle some of these items in the regular planning board context. My thought about skipping a November workshop was that the South Portland Planning Board, who we were going to meet with in November, could not meet in November, and so if we did our work first in December and then scheduled with them in January, South Portland, we might be able to take just a little more time to get the rest of these things reviewed and presented in the right fashion. With that, does that sound agreeable?
Sounds good. I think 2 meetings a month were only if we needed them. I don't think we
And as Dan suggests, perhaps we can even, if the Comprehensive Plan Committee is moving fast, we might have a and that's, the only other thing is I just would like to comment again on the letter which came from the town regarding the timing of our submissions of ordinances and so forth. I will be responding to that, and we hope that we can improve that process so that that can be dealt with. Any other points of discussion? Anybody want to bring up an agenda item? I would like to announce that both Steve and I are going to be on the Joe Russ TV show. Which is going to be scheduled for, I think, November.
It'll be nice to see Mr. Russ again.
Right. He was planning to be here tonight, but Joe Russ is a moderator now for a TV show, which has been bringing before the public town boards with a number of, for example, last night, Frank Vittori as the chairman of the town council and Michael McGovern were on TV, and there were column questions.
Is this something produced and directed by
Produced and, right, along with Lillian Bates, who is our TV expert. So for the information of the public as well, tune in on channel 38 on November 22nd at 7:30, and you may submit questions. Yes, no hard ones. And that will be entertainment before Thanksgiving for you. Any other business? If not...
Madam Chairman, just maybe a quick update for the planning board and more in the line of questions. Mm-hmm. What is the status of the congregate housing ordinance? Has that been adopted yet? Is that winding its way through the council process? And is there any prognosis on it?
The Town Council Ordinance Committee looked at it, had a list of, I think, about 16 questions, which they sent to me. I'm working on those, and we're going to be discussing that. It's one of three items to be discussed at the Ordinance Committee meeting in early November. So it's coming back fast and clear.
Okay, so there'll be two items of Planning Board concern on the November 7th Ordinance Committee meeting. One would be the farm and fish stand issue, which I presume you'd want some representation from the Planning Board.
I would hope that Mr. Timson, the chairman of that previous committee, would be able to attend.
If he remembers it, he will. And second, the congregate care. Presumably the council will have questions of not only Steve, but maybe questions of representatives of the Planning Board. We might want to have a couple of people there. Mm-hmm.
That would be very helpful, and if anyone can attend, I believe it's 4 o'clock again on November 7th.
What else?
Get at Town Hall.
What else is on their agenda for that evening? Anything
I
else, Planning Board?
I have not heard anything else. Have you? Well, I think that's going to be quite meeting unto itself. Congratulations for wrapping up a quick meeting, and if there's no further business, we are adjourned. Did you have another? Thank you.